brought to you by
Eaton Detroit Spring, proudly made in the USA.
Classic Car or Muscle Car, we want to show you how to restore your automobile and save yourself some money in the process. Sometimes we consult the pros, sometimes we mess up. But just remember, it's never a problem, it's always a project.
This week, Kara's out, Vinny steals, and Jeff shows you how to set up a Holley carburetor using parts from Summit Racing.
Honey, what are you doing out there?
Waiting on the next Super Blowout 3-day only mega sale.
You don't need a sale. You need NPD.
NPD's everyday prices are competitive with most sales, and orders arrive fast from our four strategically located superstores. National Parts Depot has quality parts for Mustang, Camaro, Chevelle, GTO, Firebird, Ford, and Chevy truck. For your free catalog, go online or call toll-free.
Working beats waiting.
All right, good to be back. I got to the garage and I was the only one there, and the keys were just dangling from the ignition. I couldn't resist. Where's my wagon? Where's my wagon? Ooh, got a little bit of rubber there.
Wagon, keys were in it. Fair game.
Been watching all these episodes, just been doing some tuning on the Autolite 4100 on this car, and it is really running nice. Ooh, a little too nice coming into these corners. Woo-hoo. And for such a big car, this 351 Cleveland with this Autolite, it really does accelerate pretty well. But it's been a while since I've been in the wagon. I gotta say, I'm kind of enjoying myself. I hadn't been in it since Jeff did the power steering upgrade. Feeling really good. Feels so good, I'm just slowing down just so I can accelerate again. There she goes. Okay, I gotta get Jeff to put some air conditioning in this car for next time I steal it. It's 100 degrees out today.
Did you have fun?
Oh yeah, that was all right.
I am never leaving the keys in my wagon again.
Oh man, whew, all that tuning you've been doing paid off.
You know what?
Might want to rotate the tires. That one spins a little bit more than that one,
yeah.
Even tread wear and everything.
You know what? Since you've done all this wonderful driving in the wagon, I think since we're doing a Holley tuning video this week, now that it's nice and warm.
Well, you've done all the work on this one, though.
Yeah, I know, but I kind of wanted to show folks how to tune a carburetor. So what I thought would be nice for you to do is to pop the hood and remove the hot Autolite so we can put the cool Holley on the car. Have fun. All right, so we've got the 69 wagon in fine tune with the 4100 Autolite carburetor, which means that we're going to do this. We're going to pull it off and put a 670 CFM Holley on there this week, mostly to show you guys how to tune a Holley. But before we do that, I want to say why we have this nice looking 670 on the table. And that's because we're going to be putting it on our 67 Mustang Fastback. Right now we're running a 750 CFM carburetor on there, and it's just a little bit too much. But we do have a problem. The other day, when we were doing some testing on the car, we took it out and lo, the hub separated on the front end on the driver's side. Had we not been at low speed, I probably would be talking to you from a hospital bed at Aiken Regional Hospital. But luckily, we were doing our testing like I always suggested you do at low speed in the neighborhood before we did anything else. Now, yes, something like this could have happened at high speed, and it would have been very horrible had it done so, but we got fortunate. So, what we're going to do now is we're going to go on and talk about the 670, setting it up, and tuning it for your car, whatever that car may be. All right, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to go over the 670 Holley that we got from Summit. Now, what we have here is a basic 670 Holley with vacuum secondaries on. And I prefer a vacuum secondary on a street car. It's just a lot easier to tune it. It's a lot more fuel efficient because you're not always banging the secondaries open every time you're running the car. A mechanical secondary, while really cool, uses an awful lot of gas on the street. Not really necessary, mostly for high performance use on cars. You're gonna see a lot of drag race duty. We do have a dual feed inlet that we got from the guys at Summit as well. Now this piece right here is just one that they have. They have tons of these. You can pick whatever you want. We like this one because it's nice and chrome, looks pretty in the engine bay. Now what we do have here is a port that is for a fuel pressure gauge, a small diameter one. This would be really nice to know what your fuel pressure is going in. A Holley typically wants to run a maximum of about 8 psi of fuel pressure from a mechanical pump or even an electric pump. You don't want to overdrive that because what it'll do is it'll overfill the bowls on your Holley. Now this is a 670 CFM Holley, and that's basically, in my opinion, a little big for our 69 wagons 351 Cleveland. A lot of guys will argue with me about that, but we're running what is basically a 480 CFM on there right now, and baby, it will light the tires. So we're going to put this on there and see if we can get a decent drivable tune out of it today. But what I wanted to go over is why this is basically a universal 670. You have a 65 main jet, a 68 secondary jet, and a 6.5 power valve, and a silver spring in the vacuum secondary. So this carburetor is overall middle of the road. And then you have an electric choke on this one. Now, the electric choke is kind of nice because you can go in and just basically pop 12 volts to it from a key on position, and voila, you'll have an operational choke. Now, our Holley is also set up with a kickdown linkage, which is this right here, for automatic. Now, this little piece that you see on here is for the type of accelerator linkage that we have on our 69 wagon. You won't necessarily get this with your Holley. This will be an open port. So, that's basically everything on the generalities of the carburetor. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to go over the specifics of what we got and what we're going to do to tune this thing out. All right, I'm going to get this box out of the way, and we're going to go over vacuum ports on this. And I'm going to flip this carburetor around this way so we can show you guys what we're talking about. Most all of your vacuum stuff on a vacuum secondary Holley is on this side of the carburetor. Unfortunately, they don't pour it out through the bottom back of the carburetor for a vacuum signal like for power brakes or anything like that, or a PCV system. Your main PCV port on a Holley is this one right here, so you would want to run to the back of the valve cover on the passenger side for PCV. This port right here is ported vacuum, and in my opinion, you don't need this. You're not going to be using this unless you're using this on an emissions-controlled vehicle, which to me seems kind of, well, pointless because, I mean, let's face it, it's a 670 Holley vacuum secondary. This thing is made for performance. It's not made to be on an emissions vehicle, but if you have something that runs ported vacuum, you can go to this. There is a lot of talk about this, and I'm going to tell you the vacuum port that you need to use for almost all aftermarket vacuum advances on distributors. All right, I'm going to flip this thing over and show you what we've got here. Now, we have two vacuum ports that are straight manifold vacuum, and that's this one here and this one. This is the one you're going to want to run for your distributor vacuum if you're running a vacuum advance on the car. And yes, I highly recommend a vacuum advance on anything that you're running because vacuum advance is going to basically be the brains of your engine. You'll want that vacuum advance on a street motor because you're going to be running it at varying speeds. You're not going to be running it at wide open. That will give you an advance on the distributor that you're not going to get if you're using a mechanical distributor that doesn't have any vacuum advance. This little port right here will save you gas money. You'll get better performance on a street engine with vacuum advance than you would get if you don't use it. This port, I don't really know what it's for, but it's really cool and large, and if you need a bigger port for something, by gum, there it is. So, let's flip this thing back over and talk about a couple of other things. All right, now we're going to talk about the idle circuit on a Holley or basically any of these style carburetors. Even the 4100 Autolite that we have on our 69 wagon right now has an idle adjustment circuit. And basically you have an idle speed adjustment screw typically back here on the back section of the carburetor. Now what I've done with this one is I've actually backed it out so that it's not even touching the idle cam, which is this right here. This takes idle out of it, screwing it clockwise puts idle into it. So a lot of guys will just go in and crank this sucker open, to idling at about 1200 RPM, and I'm going to show you what causes, what problem that causes when you do that. I'm going to open this thing up as far as it'll go to overset the idle. You'll also see that we have what's called idle mixture screws. Now on these on a Holley, what you'll want to do is take your idle mixture screws and screw them all the way in till they bottom out, and then you're going to come out 1.5 turns. So we're at bottom there. So we go 1/2, 1, and then 1/2. Now, a lot of guys will tell you 1.25 turns, and you want to do this on both sides. We're going to take the carburetor, turn it around, and do the same thing on the other side here. And go 1/2, 1.5. So now we have our idle circuit set up. This is set up too fast on the idle. You're probably at about 2,000 RPMs of idle right there. I'm going to take this carburetor, I'm going to turn it over, and I'm going to show you why that's a problem on a carburetor like this. All right, now I'm going to talk about the idle on this carburetor, and basically you'll see some slots down in here. I'm going to put an arrow on that so you can check them out. This is all the way open. You're going to be out of the idle transfer slot, and you're going to be running on the main jets at this point, and you do not ever want that. You're always going to run rich, it's always going to be a stinky carburetor, and you're not going to be happy with your idle quality. So what you'll want to do is take and back that down. I'm going to try to do this offhand and backwards a little bit for me, but I'm going to shut this all the way down initially so that the idle screw is completely off. Now I'm just going to tip it so that it's a little bit on, so it's just barely touching it before I mount it in the car. Now you're actually on your idle circuit and you should be okay. And you want to make sure you do your idle adjustment after you get the carburetor up to full operating temperature. So you're going to need to let it run for a few minutes, and then you'll want to do all kinds of adjustments like adjusting your floats and things like that. We'll do the float adjustment part of this in the car because you'll want to have fuel pressure in there so that you know that you've got a good float adjustment. We'll show you that after it's in the car. And that's the next thing we're going to do, is we're going to go ahead and start mounting this thing in our car, and then we're going to do our initial tune-in on it, and then we're going to take it for a drive so you can take a look at what we got going on with our Holley 670 carburetor.
Anytime you're working with any part of the fuel system, you really want to disconnect the negative on the battery. You don't want any stray sparks while you're working on the fuel system. And, whew, this car is hot, hot, hot. There we go.
Okay, I'm going to turn the fan off so you can actually hear what I'm saying. We ran the fan a little bit because Vinny, in his driving, heated the engine bay up. Now, one of the things we did when we were taking the other carburetor off is we put a rag underneath the fuel line so it would catch some of that fuel and wouldn't spill it off onto the intake. So, always a good idea to do that. Be sure after you do that, when it stops running over and dripping, that you take the rag out of there. If you don't, you may end up getting vapors in the air and causing a problem. Take your rag outside if you're working inside the garage. The next thing I recommend you doing is going in and actually starting to tighten down your carburetor and get it set on the plate. Now we've already got it on here, and you're going to want to go in a cross pattern to tighten these up. And I don't recommend you gorilla-ing up on these things because, quite frankly, you can over-tighten them and warp the base. A good hand tight is usually all you're going to need to make this work. And all I'm doing is going back and back-checking these to make sure they're all tight. Now you'll notice that we have our linkage on here. We've got our setup ready to rock and roll for driving the car. We were really lucky because the linkage that we had for the Autolite is just barely long enough for us to be able to use it on the Holley. That's a good thing. Now, the next thing I want to talk about is the return spring for the carburetor. All right, so on a return spring, you don't want a really heavy return spring because what that'll actually do is it can actually start to go in and wear that shaft assembly, and then you start developing a vacuum leak on the carburetor. You want a return spring that's heavy enough to put the butterflies back where they belong, but not so light that they start pulling back into an open position. Because what can happen is sometimes with the air pull through the carburetor, they can start to open the butterflies up and it'll change your idle. So you want a heavy enough spring that you're not able to move it real readily, or when you drop it, it stays in position. So the last thing I wanted to talk about is setting up your accelerator pump, which is right here. Now your accelerator pump spring and all needs to be set to about a 0.15 gap between the accelerator pump arm and the spring system. And the way you check that is you open this all the way up, then you put pressure down on the actual spring, and you make sure that this is mobile, that it's real light, that it's just barely touching, which it is. That lets me know that our accelerator pump is in the right position, and it's got the right setup on it, so we're good to go. Now, I'm going to make Vinny get in here where it's hot, like I am, and put the fuel lines on it. And the last thing we'll be talking about is setting up your electric choke.
All right, we've got the carburetor on. Last piece, we just got to put this piece of flex hose in there. And just bear in mind, this is going to be a little ugly because this isn't the permanent home for this carburetor. We're just doing this for testing purposes. And I've got one piece over here. This one side is a 3/8 of an inch nipple. And this is a 5/16 hose. So I'm going to have to do a little wrestling to get it on there. And it's still very hot under here. All right. Oh, yeah, don't forget to put your hose clamps on first.
Doing?
Well, I'm putting the fuel line on so we can test this bad boy out.
But you gotta...
Well, yes, it's not gonna look good because this is not the permanent home for this carburetor.
We won't even be able to the hood!
Oh, it'll be fine. If this is just for testing, it'll squoosh.
Squoosh?
It'll squoosh.
Just lay it over. Lay it over.
Well, but it doesn't... It's like a bad colic.
I'm out. I'm going away. All right, we got all of our fuel lines and all set up. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to get some fuel into the fuel bowl and then shut it back down to make sure we don't have any fuel leaks. We've already got our choke hooked up and ready to go. It's opened up. The engine's warm enough that it shouldn't need any choke. I'm going to use a little bit of carb choke cleaner down in here to help this thing start running. All right, hit it, Vinny. Kill it! And one of the biggest problems I've seen with these dual feed carburetors is you'll a lot of times get leaks off of these nuts, and we've got a leak here on the front but not on the back. So we're going to need to go in and tighten up this section here, and you'll want to do that. Before you start running this thing for final, you always want to check and make sure your fittings are nice and tight. So we'll get that fixed, and we're going to go ahead and try starting it up again. All right. One of the last things I'm going to show you on an initial Holley setup this week is how to adjust the floats. Now, on your typical Holley that is a double pumper or a dual feed carburetor like this one, you're going to have one of two things. You're either going to have a sight glass on the side here, or you're going to have a brass screw in the side of the float bowl. Follow your instructions that come with the carburetor, or you can download them online at Holley to set this adjustment. But I'm just going to show this to you so you get an idea of what I'm talking about. Now I'm going to do this with my modified screwdriver. Remove the float screw and set it aside. Now, the floats, in my opinion on this Holley, are a little high. I want to have a little less float in there than what I'm running, so I'm going to go in and actually drop the float a little bit. Now, in order to drop the float, you're going to go clockwise. To raise the float, you go counterclockwise. Now, this screw is not the adjustment. The screw is actually just for locking down the nut. So I'm going to take that and turn that just a little bit. And now I'm going to start the car up and see what we get with the adjustment on this thing. A little high still, maybe, but we're not going to know that until we run the car. I'm going in and actually shaking the car. You should be able to just get a little bit of a slosh out of the fuel bowl through that side port on the side. The glass ports are a little different. They're actually usually about halfway up the glass port. You just need to refer to your Holley manual to find out what the actual adjustment for final really is. All right, Vinny, shut it off.
You clear?
Yep, clear. Now immediately, it runs real nice to start. That's a good thing. But what we notice is our RPM is up at about 1200 RPM. That's too high for an initial idle on one of these. You're going to want your initial idle down around 700 or 800 RPM. Now, a lot of times if you do everything right, you actually will come off of the idle screw when you do your adjustment. it'll actually be sitting flush. I'm going to go in and take and adjust that now. Sometimes it takes it just a minute to come down. Now you'll see that the engine's starting to chug a little bit. So we're going to work in that. We're going to start working that in just a second. Now the one thing I do notice immediately at an 800 RPM idle on this carburetor is the vacuum signal is less. This one's running at 19. Our Autolite 4100 runs at about 21 inches of vacuum. So, idling nice though, not too bad. I'm pretty happy with that. So what I'm going to do now that I've got my idle set is I'm going to go in and start messing with my idle adjustment screws to see if I can play with that and clean it up a little bit. But you'll notice we've got a really good steady vacuum on this engine. We got a steady vacuum like that, it means we've got a good setup on this. No vacuum leaks that we can tell. No problems on it. All right, so what I'm going to do now is I'm going to go and adjust my idle mixture screws and show you the differences that can make. And what you want to do when you're doing your idle adjustment screws on these Holleys is you want to kind of watch the engine, move it to a new location, see what happens. You'll notice that our RPM picked up a little bit whenever we hit the adjustment screw there. Now what I'll need to do is go around to the other side of the engine and mess with that one. You'll also notice that our vacuum signal came up a little bit as well. So I'm going to go around and hit the other side. Now I'm watching my vacuum gauge and I'm watching my engine to see if anything changes, if it smooths up at all. It's not really making a whole lot of difference with what I'm doing. I'm going to shut it down. And you'll notice the idle drops. I'm going to come back in. That tells me I probably don't have any vacuum leaks. All right, our vacuum signal's at about 19. We're idling at about 800 RPM. Now, what you'll want to do is you want to see what your curb idle is, and that's whenever you put the car in drive. So I'm going to go back around to the side of the car so that Vinny doesn't run me over, and we're going to try and see what the curb idle is. Vinny, throw it down in drive. Put the brake on, please.
Really?
Put it down in drive. Curb idle's right on 600. That's a good curb idle for one of these carburetors. I can probably do a few more adjustments on the idle mixture screws to make that idle even better on a curb idle. Now the funny thing is this idle is going to change once I put the air cleaner on there. So you may need to go in and muck around with this thing a little bit more after you make those adjustments. And there's a ton of things I could do as far as going in and checking out some of the jetting and all that. It really doesn't smell that rich, which kind of surprises me. So this thing may be just about perfect for where it's sitting. So I guess that's it for right now. Go ahead and put it in park. Vinny will shut this thing off. All right, now I'm fixing to get out on the street. This carburetor is running really okay. I'm not really all that worried about it not doing what I want it to do. We're going to get out here and take it and see what we can do with it. All right, we would already be into the power valve on this one. We're at 5 inches of vacuum, dropping back. Good performance. It's not as sparkly as the 4100 is, but that's a difference in the CFM, not the carburetor. Had we gone with like a 550 or maybe even a 600 CFM carburetor, this thing would be equal to what we're getting out of our Autolite. But we didn't do that because this carburetor is going on a much higher performance engine than the Cleveland that's in here. Now what you're seeing right there when I'm going in and laying into it like that is that's where your power valve comes into effect. At 6.5 inches of vacuum, the power valve opens, dumps more fuel into the carburetor, and basically amps the fuel load up to give you better performance. Oddly enough, I am real happy with this thing out of the box. The carburetor runs really well. My experience in the past with Holleys has not been as positive as this is. This carburetor is very well sorted out. None of that part throttle stuff you used to experience with some of the Holleys when you'd get them out of the box. You'd have to do a ton of tuning to them to get them where they ran decently for you, and you'd have to spend a lot of money on tuning parts. This one, oddly enough, on this Cleveland, she's running really happy, almost to the point that I'm kind of wishing I'd had bought one for the wagon.
Love the smell of napalm. I mean,
it sits rich. And I know we're not going to tune it today. because I really didn't want to go into that. Because you start doing all the tuning stuff, you got to pull the bowls off, you got to do all that stuff, put the jets in it. It's a lot more involvement, and if somebody asks for it, we'll probably go in and show how to tune in a Holley vacuum secondary. This was basically just showing you how to set it up.
Right.
By the way, other than taking my car today,
that was fun.
How much rubber do I have left on that one tire?
You really should rotate them. For even wear and everything.
Even wear? It's just going to ride low. Left ear is kind of doing this.
Yeah.
What do I do with you? You come back after being gone for bejesus months, and now you...
If it makes you feel better, on that last burnout, both tires did spin.
I don't know why. It's never done that before.
Oh, but they did. So I was trying to,
you know, telling what you did to get that to happen.
Trying to even things out.
Well, folks, that's our show for this week. Vinny's back only temporarily. He'll be gone and then...
And back and then gone.
And then gone and back. Yeah. So anyway, do us a favor and come back and watch us next time on...
Autorestomod.
You owe me a tire.
I got a little pedal heavy and I let off the gas and it died. It's dead, Jim.
Oh,
she's alive.
Oh my God. No.
She's dead.